morning and welcome to our worship here at Faith and Bethany Lutheran Churches. I want to thank all that helped putting this video together. We thank Brianna for videoing it and also doing all the editing this week. And we thank Sandy and our singers for the music that they provide. We begin our worship today with the invocation. We welcome each other to worship in the name of our God, our Creator and Redeemer, who walks with us and promises to be with us every step of our lives. Amen. Confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity. One God who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurts through you, though you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your ways of life. Amen. now the promise of forgiveness. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave the only Son so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy, forgives you in Christ's name, and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. Please join me in the prayer of the day. Bend your ears to our prayers, Lord Christ, and come among us. By your gracious life and death for us, bring light into the darkness of our hearts and anoint us with your Spirit, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our first reading comes from 1 Samuel, the 16th chapter. The Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul? I have rejected him from being king over Israel. Fill your horn with oil and set out. I will send you to Jesse, the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of it, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' Invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you that what you shall do, and you shall anoint for me the one whom I named to you." Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, "Do you come peaceably?" Samuel said, "Peaceably. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Sanctify yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he sanctified Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, they took on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord anointed is before us." But the Lord said to Samuel, "Do not look on his appearance or his height or his stature, because I rejected him. For the Lord does not see mortals as we see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart." Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Then Jesse made Shammah pass by. And he said, "Neither has the Lord chosen this one." Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, "The Lord has not chosen any of these." Samuel said to Jesse, "Are all of your sons here?" And Jesse said, "There remains yet the youngest, but he's keeping the sheep." And Samuel said to Jesse, "Send and bring him, for we will not sit down until he comes here." Jesse sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord said, "Rise and anoint him, for this is the one." When Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the presence of his brothers, and the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon David from that day forward. Samuel then set out and went to Ramah. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Our psalm today, Psalm 23, will be read responsively by full verse. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for his namesake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I shall fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemy. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
To live your word each day.
The Gospel according to John, the 9th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. Jesus' disciples said to him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I'm in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam." Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" And he answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." And they said to him, "Where is he?" And he said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was the Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. The Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes that he opened." And he said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that he now sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he's of age, he will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put on the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time, they called the man who had been blind and said to him, "Give glory to God, we know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he is a sinner. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I've already told you, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone has opened the eyes of a person born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sin, and you're trying to teach us?" And they drove him out. Jesus heard that they had driven him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me so that I might believe in him." And Jesus said, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshiped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." Some of the Pharisees heard him saying this and said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" And Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say we see, your sin remains." This is the word of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Our gospel text today is literally an eye-opener. But it's an eye-opener in a number of ways. Just the fact that Jesus can heal the eyes of a man born blind, that in itself is an eye-opener, in the sense of it being something surprising and startling. For as the guy who was healed says, "Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone has opened the eyes of someone that's been blind." And that then is literally an eye-opener for the man born blind, for after years of blindness, he now has received his sight. But more than the physical healing, the man was also cured spiritually as his eyes were opened to a new thing. And the good news is Jesus does these healings not just as recorded in the John's Gospel for you and I to read, but he opens our eyes both physically and spiritually right now in the here and now. Yes, today's mega gospel story that we read is a real eye-opener. The story begins with Jesus and his disciples passing by a man born blind. And right away, the disciples start asking questions, for they want to get their master's take on why this man is blind. "Rabbi, who sinned? Was this man born blind because of something he did or something his parents did?" You see, in the minds of Jesus' disciples, if something really bad happened, it had to be somebody's fault, somebody's sins. And so God was punishing that person with some kind of calamity. It's like the story in Luke's gospel where a group of people came to Jesus and told him about the Galileans that were slaughtered at the temple. Somebody had to be accountable for that tragedy. So who was it that sinned? And what was the sin that created such a devastating thing? Or like the response of Job's three friends who thought Job had some unrepentant sin that he was dealing with and that's why he was suffering. But Jesus tells the 12 that there wasn't anyone or anything to put the blame on either of these circumstances. And there was no sin in this case either that caused the man to be born blind. So Jesus answers his disciples, it was not that this man sinned or his parents, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. "We must work the work of him who sent me while it's day. Night is coming when no one can work." Yes, Jesus came to do the work of God in the world, to bring healing and wholeness to a fallen people, and this man's blindness gives him occasion to do just that. For Jesus is the light of the world, and he brings light where there was darkness. Darkened eyes, darkened minds, Jesus will enlighten them both. So Jesus heals this man's blindness. But here's something else in this text that I want you to take note of. And that is, I want you to notice how Jesus does it. Jesus spits into some dirt. And he takes that dirt and he makes it into mud and then he anoints the man's eyes with that dirty concoction and he sends him off with simple instructions. "Go wash in the pool of Siloam." And the man goes off and washes and comes back seeing. And isn't that how our Lord often works? He attaches his words of promise to a visible, tangible thing. And by doing that, he works a wonderfully creative thing in our lives. It's like baptism, like Holy Communion. Baptism, where Jesus attaches his words to water and our sins are washed away. Holy Communion, where he takes bread and wine, two simple items of food. And he tells us that he now resides in us as we eat those and drink those items. And what we receive is our spiritual sight with the promise of full physical healing to come when Christ returns. So in today's gospel, Jesus gives physical sight to a man born blind. But here's what's so special about today's gospel. It only takes 2 verses for this miracle to take place, but another 39 to share the reactions of some to this miracle. Because what follows the miraculous healing is a long, controversial narrative about healing. You see, the authorities of that day, which happened to be Pharisees, wanted to look into the healing. They wanted to investigate it, probably because they wanted to discredit Jesus because they feared Jesus. For Jesus, he's the guy, especially in John's gospel, who has been giving them so much grief by exposing their hypocrisy and by undermining their prestige among the people. But there's also another matter of giving spiritual sight to the man born blind. Jesus has healed his eyes, but he's also working to heal his soul. The man's neighbors, those who knew for sure that this is the same guy that was born blind, now want to know how he gained his sight. So the man that now has his sight tells all. He says it's Jesus that did it, but he doesn't know where to find Jesus. So the neighbors take the formerly blind man to the Pharisees, the religious authorities at that time. And the Pharisees naturally want to know more about this as well, especially because it concerns Jesus, the man that they fear and are hoping to somehow get rid of. The formerly blind guy tells the Pharisees what's happening. He says, "I can see now." But the Pharisees don't want to hear that. Rather, they want to concentrate on this Jesus who is healing on the Sabbath. They want to make the time of the healing the issue and stay away from the miracle. And it's all because the Pharisees want to be in charge. And the way that they can gain and maintain power is by interpreting the law to their benefit. So they put stringent laws in the Sabbath work with consequences for Sabbath law violations. Never mind that Jesus was really fulfilling the Sabbath, which was designed to bring rest and restoration to a fallen creation. But the Pharisees want to catch Jesus doing something wrong, so they nitpick, and they understand he was doing the work on the Sabbath. And that's why they asked the blind man about their thoughts concerning Jesus. And the blind man says, "He's a prophet," which is not what the Pharisees wanted to hear. So the controversy continued. And then the Pharisees bring the cured man's parents in to question them. "Yes, he's our son, and yes, he was born blind," the parents respond. "And no, we don't know anything about how he got his sight. If you really want to know what happened, ask him. He's of age." And you wonder if the mom and dad are maybe just a little afraid of getting caught up in this Pharisee Jesus thing as well. So the Pharisees bring back the cured man for a second round of questioning. And the cured man starts, "Look, I told you what happened. How he did it, I don't have a clue. But here's the thing I know. I was blind, but now I see." And in his answer, this man who has gained his sight starts to see that God must have been at work in this Christ Jesus. For how else could such a miraculous thing happen? And by the way, he says, "Aren't you guys supposed to be the religious experts? Can't you tell what happened?" Well, the Pharisees now are really ticked off, angry with the man for telling him off, but also so angry that they kick him out of the debriefing room. But Jesus has another healing in store for this man who has gained his sight. Jesus is going to give this man a second miracle by opening his eyes spiritually. So Jesus finds this man and asks him, Do you believe in the Son of Man? And in this instance, the title Son of Man is another way of saying Messiah or Christ, the great deliverer of the promises to come. And who is he, sir, that I might believe him? The man asks. And Jesus says, you have seen him, and it is he who is speaking to you. The cured man responds, Lord, I believe, and he is I that I worship. So for a second time in this man's life, we find that Jesus has worked another healing, a greater healing. Jesus has opened the man's eyes to see the world, and now he sees God. But to realize that Jesus is the Christ is the enlightenment that we all need. For in Christ Jesus, the Son of God that came down from heaven to be with us, in him is all salvation and hope and eternal healing. Jesus is here to open our eyes, to see through faith, to know that Christ has healed all. For in Christ, our sinful self is washed away, and we again are blessed to be part of this world by way of the waters of holy baptism. And as our eyes are open, we can live in the promise of full physical healing in the age to come. Bad eyesight, hearing loss, weak knees and joints, all will be repaired and restored, and we will live with Christ and all the saints in a restored creation in perfect fellowship with each other. This is the gift that the blind man receives when Jesus opens his eyes both physically and spiritually. But there are still some, like the Pharisees in today's story, who continue to refuse to see. Yes, some of the Pharisees came to Jesus after all the events of that day and said, are we blind as well? And Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains. The Pharisees claimed to have it all together, but their pride was blinding them. They didn't think they needed a Savior. They didn't think they had anything to repent of. And so they remained spiritually blind. And their antagonism towards Jesus would only increase, which eventually would lead to the showdown that we will discuss in Sundays to come. But today, the takeaway from the story is that Jesus is the real eye-opener. So as we leave this place today, let us fix our eyes on our healing and our healer, who came to us to open our eyes to a whole new thing. Amen. Let us pray. Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all creation. Eternal God, you seal us by the Holy Spirit and mark us with the cross of Christ forever in baptism. Inspire us by your love as together we strive for justice and peace in all the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creating God, by your word you have made all things and you hate nothing you have made. Teach us to perceive the beauty of the breath of your creation, from the grandest mountain range to the smallest springtime bud. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Powerful God, you anoint kings and establish rulers. Guide the work of the heads of states and elected officials. Be with our president and his administration, our senators and House members, our governor and the state legislatures, our county, township, and community officials, and all who are part of our national judiciary. Encourage them to lead with justice and to remove barriers that impede the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Shepherding God, you lead us beside still waters and restore our souls. Keep watch over those who weep. Tend all who are sick and comfort those who grieve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our host, you fill us at your table with more than we could ever ask. Feed us with hunger for justice. Equip the feeding ministries of this congregation and community. We especially lift up the food shelves in Staples and Motley. Encourage us so that we can nourish our neighbors. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of history, with thanksgiving, we remember our ancestors in faith who care for your people. We praise you for the ways they form the faith of others and continue to inspire us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift up our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the peace with one another. And now let us pray the offering prayer. God of good gifts, receive these and all of our offerings as we present them in faithful service for the sake of your gospel. Prepare our hearts to receive you in this meal as you pour out your very presence through Christ Jesus, the wellspring of eternal life. Amen. And now the Lord's Prayer. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And now receive the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.